Random House Audio presents McNelly Knows a Ranger, a dramatization of the short story by Louis L'Amour.
It was just after sundown when the young cowhand rode into Miller's Crossing. The lingering glow in the western sky lit up the fronts of the buildings along Main Street. The small group of travelers gathered at the stage station paid him no attention as he pulled up at the hitching rail and stepped down from his horse.
That'll be the last of them, Jim.
Help you with your bags, ma'am?
Oh, thank you.
Guess you can head on over to the livery barn.
Evening then, Mr. Gandy. Get up.
Good night.
The cowhand tied his horse and then stood for a moment, taking in the street, the storefronts, and the lighted saloons. Miller's Crossing was a quiet, hard-working town, mostly. Not the kind of place where people would just disappear. Still, Noah Whipple had apparently done just that. According to his wife, he had ridden to town 4 days ago, saying he'd be back by morning, and he hadn't been heard from since. The young man paused out of habit to read a handbill which was nailed to the station wall. Able men wanted to ride with the Texas Rangers. Inquire W.A. McNelly, Captain, San Antonio. The station master eyed the stranger with curiosity.
Next stage out's the 8 a.m. to San Antone. You be needing a ticket, mister?
No, thanks.
Well, good evening to you, then.
Mm-hmm.
Turning, the lean young man removed his hat and wiped the dust from his face and neck, his features angular, almost Apache-like in the half-light. Then, thrusting his black-and-white checked bandana back into his hip pocket, he replaced his hat and stepped into the street. He'd find Noah Whipple if he was in town. He was sure of it. In the 3 months he had worked for the man, Chick Bowdrie had only been to town once or twice. There were hundreds of little cow towns like Miller's Crossing in Texas, and Bowdrie already knew plenty of them. He walked quickly up Main Street and crossed over toward the welcoming sign of the Black Kettle Saloon. A few men sat at tables and talked idly as the cowhand entered, and the bartender, who had little to do, was busy polishing the vast countertop in front of him.
Rye whiskey, please.
Why, certainly. Coming right up.
Well, the ridge stops at a little halfway over there.
Anyone hereabouts know where I can find Noah Whipple?
The bartender's back was turned when Bowdrie spoke. Bowdrie watched as the man froze for a brief moment. When he turned around with the bottle of whiskey in his hand, his face had gone white. The bartender picked up a clean glass from the bar and set it down in front of Bowdrie. The loafers at the tables glanced at each other, and one picked up a deck of cards and began riffling them nervously.
Excuse me, I said, do you know where'll I find Noah Whipple?
Noah Whipple?
That's what I said.
The bartender's Adam's apple bobbed.
They shot him.
Killed?
The bartender nodded. Bowdrie's eyes were cold. The bartender swallowed again and shifted his feet uncomfortably, staring in fascination at the dimple-like scar on the cheekbone below Chick's right eye.
It was Aaron Forbes done it, Mr.
Bowdrie. Chick Bowdrie.
Well, it's like I say, Mr. Bowdrie. Aaron Forbes shot him. Right there where you're standing. He wasn't even wearing a gun.
Bowdrie stood silent, waiting.
It was about 2 p.m. Day before yesterday, it must have been.
The bartender glanced nervously at the men seated nearby. They looked at each other and nodded.
Yep. Day before yesterday, it was. You a lawman?
No, I'm not.
Well, then why are you so interested in what happened to Noah? I can't say I remember him mentioning any family, excepting his wife and daughter, that is. And you don't look like either one of them.
Bowdrie smiled broadly. He was a stranger here. He knew that small-town folk were clannish, even suspicious by nature. The bartender was clearly a talkative soul, but Bowdrie knew he'd have to gain the man's confidence if he was going to learn anything of value here.
I was working for him. Noah took me on when I needed work real bad. He was my friend.
The bartender considered this for a moment, then appeared to make up his mind to trust Bowdrie. He began to recount what had happened without further prompting from the seated onlookers.
Well, like I say, day before yesterday, four men came riding into town. They got down and come in here. They looked to be a pretty salty outfit. They'd been riding hard by the look of their horses.
The bartender fell silent, and his gaze grew distant, as if he were witnessing the event all over again.
You said that a man named Phobe shot him. Did you recognize any of the others?
Well, the tall one I spotted right off. He had a blaze of white hair over his temple. That would be Clyde Ballard's cousin, Northup. And the slim, dark-faced youngster was Tom Ballard. The other two was Aaron Phobes and Luther Doyle.
You seem to know them pretty well.
Oh, the Ballards are pretty well known in these parts, mister.
I've heard of them.
They hole up in the Highbinders, just a few days' ride from here.
But they're a lot of hard-case outlaws, aren't they?
You betcha. It's a wonder decent folks can get by with coyotes like that around. They just waltz
Chick
in
listened
here
with
any
interest.
Time they please.
He needed time to think. He had had no reason to suspect foul play when he set out to find Noah Whipple. The man's murder put a new color on things. He was surprised and angry, but there was little in his own experience to tell him what to do next. As a young man growing up in East Texas, he had come close to running outside of the law on more than one occasion. He had heard about the Ballard gang before, and he somehow doubted that the local sheriff would be interested in going up against them, even if one of the men had shot Noah.
Right at all.
He needed to know more.
Did Noah do anything to provoke this Aaron Phobes character?
No. He come in here 3 or 4 minutes before the Ballards rode up. You knew Noah. He was a good man, no trouble to anybody.
True enough.
But he was a talker. He didn't even notice when the Ballards came in. First thing they do, they take a quick look around, see? They seen everything with that first look. We all knew who they was, even without the holdup over at Benton where they killed that cashier.
I saw the wanted posters over at the stage station.
So Noah pays no attention, really, and he goes on talking. Feller come through last night and said the Ballards was riding again. I used to know that Aaron Phobes up in the Choctaw Nation. We tried to catch his eye, but there was no stopping him. And Phobes was standing right there. Here, have another one. On the house.
Is that all he said? He used to know this man Phobes?
Oh, I wish it were. That Phobes, says Noah. That Phobes never was no account. Poison mean he was, even then. You can imagine the silence. And Noah, he just kept right on. Times are coming when they won't let thieves like that ride around the country, robbing decent people. Noah was just talking like he always does, but Phobes was standing right there to hear him.
Right. Well, what happened then?
Phobes tapped him on the shoulder. You talk too much, stranger, he said, speaking kind of low and mean. Noah, he turns around. What, he says? Then he sees who it is. Must have been mighty surprised. I couldn't see his face. But I don't think Noah ever knew Phobes, really, up in the nation or anywhere else, for that matter. It was like that. You know what I mean?
Chick Bowdrie listened, seeing the scene all too clearly, and the inevitable ending. That was Noah, all right, always talking, meaning no harm to anybody, a decent, hard-working man with a wife and a family. At least there was Joni. Thinking of her, his face tightened, and he felt empty and kind of sick inside.
So then Phobes, he said to Noah that maybe he'd like to stop the Ballards from riding the country. Maybe you'd like to try stopping them yourself, he said, just like that.
And Noah, what did he do then?
Well, you know Noah Whipple. He might have been a talker, but he was no coward. Maybe I would, he says. This country should be made safe for honest people.
Good Lord, whatever possessed him?
Well, Tom Ballard put in then. Forget it, Aaron. This here farmer doesn't even know what he's saying. Let's ride. Tom Ballard, he started for the door, with Northup following. Noah thought it was all over, and he dropped his hand. He never should have done it, but he was a habity man. He chawed tobacco, and especially when he was nervous or bothered by something, he reached for his tobacco, and Aaron Phobes shot him.
He didn't even wear a gun.
Chick looked at the rye whiskey in the bottom of his glass and thought of Joni. Only a few months before, he had ridden up to the Whipple Ranch as close to death as a man is apt to get, with 3 bullet holes in him, having lost a great deal of blood.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.